I'll deal with the essential anatomy for Botox facial injections, and in this session, I will describe the muscles of the face, concentrating mainly on muscles of facial expression, which we are mainly concerned with, and I will discuss the anatomy of wrinkle lines in the face in relation to the muscles involved, preferred sites of injections, and possible complications. I will also outline briefly the blood supply and nerve supply of the face. I'll deal with the anatomy of wrinkle lines. As you can see here, that facial wrinkles lie at right angles to the line of pull of the underlying facial muscles. Horizontal wrinkle lines of the forehead are formed by frontalis muscle of occipital frontalis. So the wrinkle lines are perpendicular to these muscle fibers. Frontalis muscle, we have two frontalis muscle, one on the right, one on the left, and centrally there are no muscle fibers. As you can see here, that the muscle extends laterally beyond the mid-pupillary lines. This should be kept in mind while injecting this muscle. The injection points should be extended laterally and not to be confined to the area in between the pupillary lines. Now this is to show you what happens if the injection points are confined to the mid-pupillary lines. What happens is what we call these wrinkle lines, which are called the Mephisto sign. Mephisto is a short for Mephistopheles, which is a devil that appears in a number of legends and fictional works. You can see the shape of his eyebrows elevated on the lateral side. And so the injections, again, I repeat, Botox injections in the frontalis muscle should not be confined to the midpupillary lines. The injection should extend lateral to the midpupillary lines to prevent the formation of the Mephisto sign. On the other hand, it should be understood that over-treating frontalis might result in brow ptosis, because this muscle, the frontalis, is the dilator mechanism here, and therefore if it is over-treated, then the sphincter mechanism will come into action, and the tone of this muscle, orbicularis oculi, the orbital part, will result in brow ptosis. Now, aging and muscle activity of orbicularis oculi muscle here will result or contribute to lateral brow ptosis. And this is compensated by a contraction of the opponent muscle, which is frontalis of occipital frontalis, and this will lead to horizontal lines on the lateral side of the eyebrow. To reduce the activity of orbicularis oculi, injection is given in the superior and lateral aspect of the orbicularis oculi muscle, and thus creating a lifting effect. This is what we call lateral brow lift. Glabellar lines are created by the action of the corrugator supercilii. This is the corrugator supercilii muscle, which draws the eyebrows downwards and medially, and result in these vertical lines. And it's also contributed by the action of the procerus muscle. Actually, corrugator supercilii result in vertical lines between the eyebrows, while procerus muscle contraction result in horizontal lines in between the eyebrows. And this is where to inject for corrugator supercilii. The injection should be given in the eyebrow above the orbital margin, and the injection should be deep injection for corrugator supercilii, because the muscle is deep, as we mentioned earlier. It is located deep to orbicularis oculi muscle, so the injection should be given deeply. And for the procerus muscle, another injection is given close to the midline. Some textbooks mention a muscle which is called depressor supercilii. Actually, the nature of this muscle is disputed, and few printed anatomy textbooks include it in the literature. Anatomically speaking, many people consider it as part of orbicularis oculi muscle, and the fibers of the depressor supercilii originate on the medial orbital rim near the lacrimal bone and insert into the medial aspect of the bony orbit inferior to corrugator supercilii. You don't need to worry much about this muscle. Mainly, there is the corrugator supercilii muscle and the procerus muscle, which constitute these glabellar lines, whether vertical or horizontal glabellar lines. The other wrinkle lines are the lines that form in the lateral canthal region. These are called the crow's feet, and they are caused by the contraction of orbicularis oculi muscle, the orbital part of orbicularis oculi muscle. You can see here that the wrinkle lines will be formed perpendicular to the muscle fibers of orbicularis oculi, and because the muscle fibers of orbicularis oculi are concentric and they bend, then the wrinkle lines are radiating in different obliquities. Injection is given close to the lateral canthus of the eye, and care should be taken that the injection points are not so close to the orbital margin, because sometimes the injection might infiltrate inside the orbit and affect the lateral rectus muscle. Lateral rectus muscle is an intraorbital muscle that is attached to the eyeball and cause lateral deviation of the eyeball. So if this muscle is paralyzed, then it will result in a medial squint. It is always recommended that when injecting around the eye, the injection should be about 1 centimeter away from the orbital margin, because otherwise infiltration of the eyelid, the upper eyelid, might result in paralysis of levator palpebrae superioris muscle, which is the muscle of the which is located in the upper eyelid, and this definitely will result in ptosis. Bunny lines are another kind of wrinkle lines that appear on the lateral and dorsal aspect of the nose, and they may extend out to the lower eyelid. They are caused by the contraction of nasalis muscle. Injections are given on the lateral side of the nose into the nasalis compressor nares muscle, but they should be limited to levator labii superioris iliac nasi, because if the injection is given more laterally, it might involve levator labii superioris iliac nasi and result in a little bit ptosis of the upper lip, because this muscle, levator labii superioris iliac nasi, is not only attached to the nose, but the muscle fibers are attached to the upper lip as well, as the name indicates. Marionette lines are another kind of wrinkle lines. They run down from either side of the mouth. Actually, a marionette is a puppet which is controlled from above using wires or strings. The marionette lines are caused by contraction of depressor anguli oris, this muscle, depressor anguli oris. And you can see here that these are the marionette lines before and after injections, how they disappear. Injections should be given at least 1 centimeter away from the corner of the mouth, 1 centimeter away from the corner of the mouth, here and here. A second injection site might be given a little bit more laterally to involve the upper fibers of platysma muscle, which might cause depression of the angle of the mouth, as was mentioned with the action of platysma muscle. It should be borne in mind that chemodenervation of the chin musculature can affect the ability to eat or speak. So high doses of the injection, or an injection that is too close to the corner of the mouth, might lead to asymmetry. So try to avoid the corner of the mouth. This should be avoided to avoid asymmetry after injection, as well as to avoid difficulties while eating and drinking, because if the injection is given close to the angle of the mouth, then this will affect the sphincteric mechanism of the mouth and might result in drooling. The cobblestone appearance of the chin is caused by contraction of mentalis. This is mentalis muscle. It is located medially, as has been indicated, and it is a deep muscle. In spite of its depth, superficial injections work well. Injections should be kept at least, again, 1 centimeter away from the lip in order to minimize the adverse effects, as has been mentioned earlier, and also to avoid ecchymosis and hematoma formation. Actually, ecchymosis and hematoma formation might occur in many other places where injections are given on the face, and this is related to the extensive vascularity of the face. There is a lot of blood supply in the face, and it's also related to the easy spread of fluid and bleeding because of the absence of deep fascia and compartmentalization of the face. So again, the injection should be given away from the lip in order to avoid competence issues, in order to avoid drooling, in order to avoid problems with the speaking, and so on. The gummy smile is an excessive display of the gingival tissue on smiling. There are several etiologic factors here, skeletal, gingival, and muscular factors. Actually, Botox injections are only suitable when you are sure that it's a muscular factor and not skeletal or gingival factor. In this case, the muscular factor is due to hyperactive lip elevator muscles, and these include the levator labii superioris muscle. This is levator labii superioris, levator labii superioris elecnesi muscle, and the zygomaticus minor and the zygomaticus major muscle. And in this case, the injection is given along the nasolabial folds to include these muscles. Finally, I will deal with Nefertiti lift. The well-defined jawline with a long neck has been a sign of beauty since the time of ancient Egyptians. Nefertiti lift was named after Queen Nefertiti, whose bone structure continues to be admired in modern times. Nefertiti and actress Angelina Jolie are both extremely attractive. Their jaws reflect the modern-day ideal of beauty. Actually, Nefertiti's bust was used as a logo for the American Society of Aesthetic Plastic Surgery. In some people, excessive platysma muscle activity can cause marked exaggeration over the overlying skin where they join into the lower jaw. And so, relaxing platysma muscle by injecting into the muscle fibers of the muscle just underneath the skin creates a well-toned and smooth neck and a lifted jawline.